Red-Handed Irish Red Ale. Nice simple ingredients. It's from Stone Angel Brewing in Winnipeg. A medium-bodied malt with subtle toasted grain and caramel notes. Yeah, and very slight hop bitterness. It's quite nice, actually. Not quite as dark as what I'm used to, but very nice little beer. So, before I get started here, I'm going to make one slight upgrade. This old cutting mat is old. It is very, very old. And I'm not sure if you can see or not, but it's kind of warped over there and over here from heat, from soldering directly on it. Makes it a little bit challenging when I'm building a model kit. So I was at Princess Auto the other day and picked up this one. Just get that guy out of there. Yeah, you can see how warped that guy is, right? So in addition to being flatter, nice and flat actually, and a little bit darker, an important feature, this one is in metric, as opposed to those other obsolete units. So I'm pretty happy about this. I'm not sure whether this angle thing or these circle measurements will come in handy, but I think having modern measurements on here will help, and having it be nice and dead flat will definitely help. Although not for today's video, because today I'm doing a kit build. This little kit here, let me just get the knolling part done. There. It is this little EQ kit board. Microphone there. All the rest of the printing is this way up. Four transistors, an LED, a bunch of resistors and capacitors, some of which are labeled that way and some are labeled that way, strangely. Decent solder mask on the back. It's got solder pre-tuned pads. And it is the, what is that called? FR4, I think, the fiberglassy type stuff. So, any guesses as to what it is so far? It is this circuit here. It's a sound-operated switch. And actually, this circuit is basically two different bits of circuitry glued together. This part over here is just a little two-transistor microphone preamp. Very basic. And this side is a flip-flop implemented in transistors. Basically, when it gets a signal here, it's just going to change state. One will be on, one will be off at any given time. So, just for fun and games, let's just quickly go through this a little bit. Let's just assume that this is the one that turns on it at power up, which means that this will be a low resistance path here. So that point will essentially be ground, or the low voltage, which will pull the base of this one low and hold it off, which means this up here will be high, which will continue to pull this guy up. When a pulse comes in from the little amplifier here, it will disrupt this through these two little capacitors and the diodes, depending on whether it's a positive going or negative going pulse. That shouldn't matter, but it will disrupt it enough that it should switch states. That one will go on and that one will go off, and the same logic will hold it in that state. And then this little amplifier here is just very classic, basic NPN transistor amplifier with, I'm assuming, relatively high gain, because it's got to get from a microphone level, which is, you know, millivolts, low millivolts, up to enough to give these guys a nudge and flip them over and overcome their steady state. So let's see if that's what actually happens when we put this thing together. And I'm not going to solder directly on my cutting mat because, as I mentioned before, I don't want it to get warped by heat in the same way as the other one did. So we'll bring in this little board holder guy here. So let's get started and see what these resistors are. Looks like they are 10K, and there's five of them. So we'll start there. Find where all the 10K resistor positions are. Oh, this could be interesting soldering around my board holder guy here. Get in there. Yeah, that's kind of... Oh, I can move it around, I guess. Bend those leads out of the way. There's one 10K. There's another one there. So, yeah, I don't know. Who remembers the old TV commercial from the original clap switch, The Clapper? I'm guessing if you do, you probably got as much gray hair as me. Or you're really into retro TV commercials for some reason. It seemed like a magical thing back in the day. But these days, it's considered pretty cheesy. Something that grandma might have or something for turning on a lamp in the corner of the house. Actually, that impression happened fairly quickly after the product was released, if I remember correctly. That said, I do have one in my box of Christmas tree decorations for controlling the lights in the Christmas tree. And the kids think it's quite a fun little thing. So there's the 10K resistors. I think I'm going to jam a bunch of resistors in before I flip it over and solder, just so that I'm not constantly flipping things over. So the next batch of resistors is these three here, which are 2.15K according to that, which means they're probably 2.2K, and the schematic says that there's three of them. One in the base there, and two in the collector of these guys. Okay, this one looks like it's providing some of the, just current limiting the bias current of the microphone a little bit. And I think it's also creating a bit of an RC filter there, which would be a high pass filter, which makes sense. You don't want, if you're controlling with a clap, there's a fair bit of high frequency energy there. So that makes a little bit of sense. So 2.2K, there's a one over here by this other holder. And again, it's all jammed up in there. And the second one is right there. And where is the third one? Do you see it? Well, there it is up there. Beside connector 2, which is the 5-volt power input. Okay, I think that's enough that I can probably solder them. And I'm sure these leads are going to get in my way. But I'm just going to go for it anyways. So using a medium-sized tip here. Oh yeah, that board solders pretty well. Is that in focus? Probably better now. Not sure whether you can hear it in the background, but I've got a little tiny fan running just off to the side there, just to blow the fumes away so that they're not obscuring the camera lens or getting into my eyes. Or my lungs, I suppose. Hopefully that noise isn't too distracting for you guys. Yeah, this little board solders pretty easily. This forest of components legs is a little bit much, but it's not as bad as some that I've done. I'm just trying to speed this up just a little bit because of the video. You didn't solder very well. There, clean tip helps. I'll slide that down a little bit to get this last one here. Is that everybody? Looks like it. Quick haircut. Okay, just a quick little inspection. I think I want to clean up a couple of things here. And just get that solder splash. Oops. Yeah, that looks reasonable. So what's next? More resistors, I guess. So these ones, I think I see an orange on there, which is a 7. So that'll be 4.7K times two pieces. There's 47s and 4.7s on here, and 470s. These are the two 4.7s. One there and one on the floor. Okay, well, I was searching for that. The two 4.7s are the collector resistors for the amplifier section. And here is our wayward resistor. So that leaves only three resistors left. This one is a 470 ohm. Which is either that base resistor there or... Actually, no, that's the only 470 ohm. Okay, so it's that base pull-up resistor. And this one is 470K. What are you doing, 470K? Oh, wait, that's 470K. Where's the 470 ohm that I just put in? Oh, there it is there. Okay. That's a current limiting resistor from there. Okay. So the 470K that I got in my hand is that base resistor. And it just goes over here. Which makes a certain amount of sense because there's the microphone, there's the first transistor in the amplifier. That seems reasonable that it would be in close proximity. Okay, so that is 47K and that is marked 47K right there. And there's room for one more resistor over here, a 1K resistor. Ah, there we go. Is that in fact a 1K? Yes, it is. And the 1K resistor goes up here, and it is the current limiting resistor for the LED. So one thing, over the years, I've gotten used to using larger solder. Just because that's what I had available. But now that I've got this nice lightweight solder here, I have to adjust how much I push into the join. Because I find I'm always erring on the side of under. It's just something that you have to get used to when you change tools. Not a huge adjustment, it's just what you get used to, I guess. Man. That little breeze blowing across here from the fan to pull the smoke out, I can actually feel it cooling off what I'm my work. Maybe it's just the back of my hand getting cool. Okay, those guys are all soldered. Haircut time. All right, what's next? How about capacitors? So there's three 104s, one 103, and one microfarad electrolytic. Let's do the ceramics first. Let's get the 104s in. And they go, this guy goes down this corner. Where's the other two? There they are up there. Right, because those are both in the base circuit of the flip-flop transistors. That makes sense. And this one is that input capacitor between the microphone and the first transistor. Okay, the other two capacitors, there's the 103. This one here, which is... What's he doing? It's this one here in the bottom of the base circuit of the amplifier. And the one microfarad electrolytic. There's two electrolytics. What? Why didn't I spot those earlier? Oh yeah, there's one up there. That's just a power supply filtering capacitor. No, that's 47. Okay, now I have to be careful. So that one's power supply filtering, and this one is, looks like it's the feedback part of the amplifier circuit. Okay, there we go. That one's 47, and that one's 1 microfarad. Okay. 1 microfarad goes down here. Negative goes to the shaded side of the screen print. That is the 47. Negative goes to the shaded side. Yep. I probably don't need to spread the heat around on these guys just to protect. Uh-oh, that's not good. Where's my wick? There's me solder wick. Getting a little carried away in here. Too much talking and not enough paying attention to what I'm doing. There we go. That's more better. That one doesn't look ideal. It's a little bit more solder. Like I was saying earlier, when you're changing to a finer gauge solder, sometimes it takes a little bit of adjusting. I mean, there's what I used to use for most everything. So it's, just getting the quantity right takes a little bit of adjusting. Oh, got one more capacitor that I didn't do. That's the little 103. Got distracted when I put a bridge in that one and I forgot about them. Okay, on to, let's grab the two diodes, I guess. So that's these two diodes here. They're just small signal diodes, but it's important, because they are a directional device after all, to get them facing the right way. Resistors don't care. And you'll notice that I've demonstrated that by not caring which way I put the resistors in, because it's only cosmetic. And now I know it bothers some people, but it really doesn't bother me that much. I suppose if you were a person who has the eyes to read the color code properly, it might bother you a bit more. But I believe I've explained to you guys before that being somewhat colorblind, I don't pay any attention to the colors, because color is unreliable information. That's also why I'm checking all the resistors with my meter rather than just trusting the color code, because the color code doesn't mean anything to me. Hmm. board holder is a little bit awkward when you're working at a tiny board like this, but I'm making do. And I was leaning up against it with the iron, and those plastic grabbers aren't getting all melty. So look, okay. That one needs a little bit more of a touch. That was something I did previously anyway. Okay. Starting to run out of passive components and things that can be damaged easily by heat. Let me rephrase that. I'm running out of things that can't be damaged easily by heat. Not that these basic NPN transistors are something that I would have to worry about damaging too much anyway. But it's just the habit that I've gotten into over the years. Soldering the least fragile things first. And the least static sensitive things first. Again, not a concern in this case. But it's just the habit that I've gotten into. One condenser, a microphone module. They are polarized devices. And you can see on the back of here that this pin here is connected to the case through that little set of spidery tracks there. So that would be the negative. And the way this is positioned, it puts the positive on that side, and the screen print is printed in such a way that the microphone only wants to go one way anyway, which is that way. What else while I've got it? Well, I might as well do the LED, which goes that way. Solder up Mr. Microphone here. And the LED. I noticed that in parallel with, okay, so this is the LED's resistor right here, and there's the LED, and in parallel with that, there's this set of pads, which there's no connector came with the kit, but that would be J1. So if you wanted, where's J1? There it is up there. So if you wanted to use this kit to drive something else, that's where you'd connect it. Well, I don't know what you'd want to. Probably an opto-isolator and then a relay would be the best option if you wanted this thing to control something line voltage, like, say, your Christmas tree. Although, I don't know that I would want to use a homemade thing for line voltage project like that. To each his own. So now, all that is left is the four transistors, which, according to the schematic, are all 9013 NPN transistors. Yes, they are. Stuff them into their positions and give them a quick soldering, and then we should be ready to test. See how many mistakes I made. Possibly I should have chosen a finer tip for this. But we'll make do. Not everybody has the luxury of having a bunch of different solder tips that they can swap to. And I know I certainly didn't when I was starting in this hobby decades ago. So it's okay to make do with what you have. Don't let not having a fancy soldering station or unlimited tools stand in the way of you starting your hobby. If you want to get into it, just work with what you've got. Flexibility is a useful skill to have, especially if you're going to be repairing electronics for a career at some point. Being able to adapt and work with what you got will serve you well. Okay. That's everything soldered except for that one right there. Why didn't that one get soldered? There you go. All right, I got 5 volts on the little power supply here. And current limiting set to about 3/4 of an amp. It's probably a little high for experimenting, but that shouldn't matter. So plug that guy in and turn him on. Oops, turn him on. Drawing like 4 milliamps. Okay. What happens if, ha ha ha, there we go. Now it's drawing 6 milliamps. And it's not triggering on my voice, just that. What happens if I back off a little bit? I'm back about a foot behind the camera. Well, that's kind of neat. Well, thanks for watching. That was just a fun, chill little project to throw together. And another one of those sort of classic kind of circuits that you'd often find in the 101 circuits to start with, to start your electronics hobby with, kind of books. If you have any questions or comments about this guy, let's hear about him down in the comments section. That'll be fun. Do you actually remember the original clapper that they were selling on TV back in the, what was it, 80s, I guess, probably? Anyway, thanks for watching. I will talk to you later.